This is my heartbeat song, and I'm gonna play it. Been so long, I forgot how to turn it up, 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 up all night long, up, up, up all night long. You, where the hell did you come from? You're a different, different kind of fun, and I'm so used to feeling numb.
Cut my bangs with some rusty kitchen scissors. I screamed his name till the neighbors called the cops. I numb the pain at the expense of my liver. Don't know what I did next, all I know I couldn't stop. Word got around to a bus live and a Baptist. My mama's phone started ringing up the hood. I can hear her now saying she ain't gonna have it. Thank you.
right. Hi, guys. Who do we have here today?
Hi.
Couple familiar faces. Happy to see ya. Thanks for coming on I was gonna say a Monday evening, but it's not Monday, is it? It's Tuesday. One second. I don't know what the weather's like in Utah, but it is 97 degrees right now at 7:30 at night. It feels like it's 104. It's miserable.
It's pretty hot here too today. It's been windy the last couple days, but no, I've been melting today.
But the wind like helps a little bit. We have a
human. It's been like gross windy though, like just blowing up dirt in your face, and it's not like.
Not fun.
Yeah, no.
All right. Well, just like the other reviews, if you have watched or some of you guys have participated, I have a Jeopardy. This one is a super duper Jeopardy. There's more questions. This is my favorite one because I'm a dork and it's themed, and I have cute little songs to go along with each of the categories, because if you don't know me, I'm quite extra. So everything has to do with that. So the rhythm is gonna get ya is all about cardiac rhythms. These boots are made for walking are about our peripheral diseases, arterial disease or venous diseases. Under pressure, blood pressure. 99 Luft Balloons has to do with aneurysms and whatnot. I Can't Feel My Face, stroke. And then Bad Medicine is going to be pharmacology related to any of that. So again, this is my favorite one. So lots of stuff we'll go over. The Rhythm Is Gonna Get Ya has pictures of rhythms, which, as you've been told, the pictures won't pop up on your quiz, on your exam, but questions about treatments and things like that will. So that's kind of where the discussion is going to deviate towards. So some of the questions are much easier than others. Sometimes I really had to try to stretch them to make them fit, but regardless, this is where we're at. So small group, we can just take it as it goes. We can do categories at a time. Doesn't matter to me. I don't care either way. You guys tell me what you want. This is your reveal.
That screen is scary.
I would like it like categories at a time, but I mean, I'm not picky. Anything's cool with me. So.
Okay, we can do categories at a time when everything's kind of all together. The only thing that it doesn't work out with is the farm, because that'll be kind of all over the place. But all right.
Okay.
So whoever wants to go first can pick first.
Let's do Under Pressure for 100.
Okay. I am the desired blood pressure.
Oh, 120 over 80? No. 90 over 6.
120 is correct.
120 over 90? Mm-hmm. Oh, I said that.
Did you say 80? Okay, yeah. We like anything under 80. So anything less than that is ideal. Anything less than 100, though, is kind of where we get into like the category. So I always think of like 120 over 60s. Those are really healthy numbers. 110 over 60, fantastic. Okay, so let me pull up my other sheet so I know where we're at. Okay. I'm missing one. Carry on.
Do you care, Alex, if we do it like 900 or whatever? You just want to stay in the same column?
Oh, no, I don't care at all. You guys do whatever.
Okay, let's do Under Pressure for 600.
I am the number one complication of hypertension.
Is that coronary artery disease? No, that's not for hypertension. Oh, stroke? No.
Okay. Not stroke. Number one cause of hemorrhagic stroke is hypertension. Who are our martyrs?
The kidneys. Oh, so kidney failure.
So we have kidney injury. Any type of kidney disease is going to be the number one complication. Hemorrhagic stroke, what can occur from uncontrolled hypertension for a long period of time? Heart failure, because if it's pumping too hard for so long, can lead to that. And then our peripheral artery and peripheral vascular disease as well. So lots of complications can occur. Kidney disease is the number one complication. What else? I think that's it. Remember, once the kidneys start getting involved, that means things are really, really not going well. Okay. We're not going to work now. Okay. All right.
Let's do under pressure for 300.
Ooh. I think I screwed up. Okay. I did. Here we go. So I am caused by another disease, i.e. renal disease.
Hypertension.
Which kind of hypertension?
Be secondary hypertension.
So secondary hypertension is caused by another disease. And usually if we can fix that disease, we can fix the hypertension. Pregnancy. Hypertension during pregnancy is a very common thing. They have the baby, boom, hypertension goes away. Kidney disease is one of those ones that heart disease can cause kidney disease, but kidney disease can happen for any other reason as well, because it takes a lot of crap. And it can lead to hypertension because that RAA pathway gets kind of damaged, basically. All right. My correct responses key is not working here. So, all right.
Let's do under pressure for 200.
There may be no clear-cut reason for me.
Would this be the idiopathic hypertension?
Yeah, which is primary hypertension. So sometimes we don't know the cause, or it could be a genetic component, something along those lines that can be the cause. But oftentimes with primary hypertension, we don't know why. So, okay. Should I just go down the category then?
Let's just do 1,000. Let's just get it out of the way. Let's just
All right. So I am characterized with a blood pressure of greater than 180 over 20 with signs of organ damage.
Is that hypertensive crisis?
Specifically. So remember, crisis is the blanket term for either urgency or emergency.
Is this one emergency because the gap between the 80 and the 20 is so small?
It's not because of the gap, but because of one other thing.
Because the organs are getting damaged.
Yep. So urgency, remember, think of it like, yep, I got stung by a bee. I'm going to urgent care. So my blood pressure is high, but my organs are not affected yet. With hypertension emergency, that's the worst it can be. Other organs are being affected and are being damaged. So we have to take care of that right away. So with urgency, no other organs are involved. We'll give oral medications, bring down that blood pressure about 20-25%. And then emergency gets IV blood pressure medications. We need to bring it down quick before other things start occurring. So those are the big differences between the two. All right. So now I'm gonna there. Now it's working. Woohoo! Okay. Hi, Helen.
Let's do what?
Oh, Helen joined. I was saying hello.
Hi. Oh, let's do 400.
Okay. So for patients taking antihypertensive medication, these signs and symptoms need to be taught to the patient.
Dizziness.
Signs and symptoms of low blood pressure, like dizziness, fatigue.
Hypertension. I know I'm way overthinking it. I'm like,
Courtney, what were you gonna say?
Also, just like signs and symptoms for electrolyte imbalances, depending on what antihypertensive medication they're on. Some of them can mess with potassium and whatnot, so we'd want to watch for those symptoms.
Absolutely, because antihypertension medications also include our diuretics. So our potassium-sparing diuretic is what?
Spironolactone.
And then our potassium dumping diuretics.
Furosemide. Is Lasix the same as furosemide? It's like one in the same. Okay.
Yep. Lasix is the brand name. So we teach you, because NCLEX teaches generic, real world, it's going to be what's easiest to pronounce. And every person is going to say Lasix versus furosemide. And then hydrochlorothiazide is kind of like, it dumps a little bit, not a ton, but it's like kind of a baby diuretic almost. But yeah, definitely those electrolyte imbalances. Remember which ones cause which. So with furosemide, hypokalemia is what we're monitoring for. And then with spironolactone, if that were to be given, is it often? Not so much, but it could be. Hyper is what we would look for. So 9 times out of 10, it's hypokalemia because furosemide dumps. And then those other symptoms of low blood pressure, like you mentioned. So dizziness, lightheadedness, fatigue, syncope, anything that it just works too well. And it's not just the patient, the family members need to know this too. Okay.
Under pressure. It makes me just want to sing that song every time I say it.
That's what I did last semester, and they kind of looked at me like I had stuff on my head because I was excited about it. But you said 500?
Yeah.
Okay. So I should be kept to help keep track of blood pressures. And why?
Is this like a blood pressure log, like a diary of your blood pressure, so you can keep track and see if there's like differentiation and let your provider know if you're having issues?
Right. And what can happen based off of our findings?
Isn't it if it stays, the systolic stays over 140, they can get off from the hypertensive medication?
Yeah, we can start to wean them off of some of them. So if we get that blood pressure controlled, we can get them off. So this is one of those interventions that we want to teach them and, you know, say it doesn't have to be forever. If we make the right changes, diet, exercise, following up with medications, potentially you can get off. Is everybody going to get off meds? No, because we have that sometimes that reasoning that just, we don't know why, but the goal is to not be on meds for forever. So, okay. Seven, eight, or nine?
Nine.
Modifiable risk factors for hypertension.
Smoking, your diet, diabetes, what you eat, your sodium intake, exercise,
stress,
Stress.
Oh, stress is one.
Your weight.
The opposite of what we're all doing right now.
Sitting, walking.
Getting moved. Preventing that sedentary lifestyle. Absolutely. So smoking, stress, obesity, alcohol, diet, getting you moving.
But alcohol is only just minimized, right? You can still drink, but you can like have to keep it at a.
Like a glass of red wine.
Okay.
Because red wine is good for the heart, but we don't want a whole bottle of wine every unfortunately. So we just have to control it. Yeah. Tequila shots, not so good.
Will that ruin my weekend?
All right. 7 or 8.
Let's do 8.
Let's do eight.
All right, let's go with 8. Let's talk about heart healthy diets.
Less than 2 grams of sodium.
How many?
2 grams.
2 grams sodium.
Don't you have sadly to no fried foods.
Yeah.
No.
And watch out for the salt substitutes.
Don't you want to limit your fluids to less than 2 liters as well?
Depending on if they have heart failure or not. So if they just have like high blood pressure, we still want them to have, as long as there's no other reason, they would have to restrict their fluid.
You want to eat more lean meats?
What are lean proteins?
Like chicken and fish and not red meat.
Or if we do small ounce sizes of red meat. Fresh fruits, fresh veggies, little to no booze. Processed foods, limit the processed foods, which is one of the probably the most difficult things to do with vending machines and being on the go. Sugar isn't really on a heart healthy diet in terms of like we don't restrict it, but if we're worried about like obesity and weight loss, then it would be. All right, and then we'll do the last one, which is great for the last one because it's the complete opposite of hypertension. So in the event that we drop the blood pressure or something else happens and we have low blood pressure, how do we treat it?
Give them like some type of stimulant.
Give them fluids.
Fluids. Oh yeah, fluids.
Mm-hmm. And what kind of drugs can be given if the fluids don't work?
No, that's not it.
Would it be pressors?
They are pressors. So remember, when we're talking about needing to raise the blood pressure, we want to constrict everything to force it. So pressors press and we'll raise the blood pressure. So things like norepinephrine or dobutamine or dopamine will help with that. So usually we go to fluid. And vasopressors should be given through a central line. All righty. Let me look at our notes too and see if there's anything we didn't hit on with hypertension. I feel like you guys picked the easiest one to go with first. let's see here. Risk factors. What about symptoms of hypertension? Are there any?
Not until it's too late, it's very severe.
Yeah, usually we don't have a ton of findings. That's why people go for years without being diagnosed, because it doesn't say, hey, you have high blood pressure. If we do have symptoms, how would they present themselves?
Headache, flushing, they might have a bloody nose, they might have visual changes depending on how bad the blood pressure is.
100%. We talked about education, journaling, recognizing symptoms. Make sure that we're enforcing that A, hypertension can't be diagnosed by one single reading. We need multiple readings, times apart. And that adherence to a regimen is important. If you're on a medication, we want you to take it every day. Check your blood pressure every day. You know, change your diet, change your exercise, make all these lifestyle modifications that you can so we can get you off of them. Follow up. Don't just start taking your metoprolol and call it a day. Make sure that we're following up appropriately, and that education is given in a way that they can understand. Language that is meets their educational needs. And we jump more into meds in a little bit. So any other questions about hypertension? All right. Hi, newbies.
Hello.
Christy, you want to pick the next category?
Sure. I know everyone is avoiding it, but it's the rhythm is going to get you.
All right. So we're going to jump into heart rhythms next. Awesome. Do you want to start at the beginning? We want to work our way down. You can pick wherever.
I don't know if you put it as the easiest ones on top, but let's go easy with 100.
All right. So don't freak out if you can't get the rhythm, because we're going to be focusing more on interventions and things like that. But what do you see here?
This is just normal sinus rhythm, right?
It's just normal sinus rhythm. So we have a P wave, we have a QRS, we have a T. P wave, QRST, okay, P wave, everything looks like I have it going down because I always looked at the whole strip. If I measured it, it's going to be the same equidistant throughout. So I have a regular rhythm and my PR interval is going to be less than 0.2 if I were to count these itty bitty little boxes, or at like 0.16. So normal sinus. I have nothing exciting to teach you about normal sinus. This is what we want.
So how is that going to be presented in a question on the test? Like if we don't get this strip?
Yeah, that's what I wondered. Like, how is it going to be like worded, you know?
Well, normal sinus wouldn't be on here, but it could be a question like the nurse determines her patient is in atrial fibrillation. What medications would the nurse anticipate the patient being on, or what interventions would they do? What kind of teaching would need to be done based on that rhythm? Basically, everything you filled in on that little chart is what we're gonna, would be fair game. So if we get to VTAC, what's the first thing we look at? If we have a systole, what's the first thing you do? Or, you know, that sort of thing.
Okay. So printing off that EKG sheet from class, that would be our best study guide with this stuff?
Yeah, or saving your own version and adding your own notes, because sometimes, you know, you don't like the way that people worded things, but definitely interventions, teachings, what causes it?
Well, I'm glad I picked an easy one to begin with, so.
We did. All right. Just go right down the line.
Yeah. A systole.
All right. So your patient is found to be in a systole. What is your next course of action? That sounds like a good test question.
CPR and epinephrine.
So before we start CPR,
check their pulse and see if they're breathing.
And before we even, well, and while we're doing that, what should we check?
Call for.
Anybody work on a telephone right now?
Oh, to see if everything's connected, all their lines and all that stuff.
Yeah, if nothing fell off their chest and it's just not reading it.
Mm-hmm. So always look at your patient, not at the monitor, because the monitor could lie to you. You get all excited. You're like, oh my God, I need to start CPR. And you just go like this. And then all of a sudden your patient is like, what the what? When it was just like their lead fell off. So check your patient. Check if there's a pulse. Check your connections. Call a code. Start CPR. High quality CPR. Is this a shockable rhythm? No.
No.
You have to do CPR with this rhythm. If you shock them, ain't nothing gonna happen. What causes asystole? Ooh.
Is it because there's no electrical activity in the heart?
Because why?
No oxygen, I think.
No oxygen? Because why? Now I sound like a four-year-old.
Why?
I would drive my clinical students crazy. I'm like, so what? So what? Why? So what?
Well, like if there was a blockage in like one of the coronary arteries and that it couldn't get oxygen to the heart and then it just gives up after a while.
Mm-hmm. So with asystole, this is what we call cardiac arrest. We have no movement going on in the heart whatsoever. No electricity is happening. Causes of this can vary. It could be an MI. We're not getting blood going through. It could be hypoxic. Something happened with the respiratory system. It could be massive blood loss. They were in a trauma and there's nothing to circulate and the pump just goes. But basically with this, again, we have no movement, no heart rate, and we need to start that high quality CPR. We need to start epi, 2 minutes, cycle through, and then we switch out. If the asystole goes on for extended periods of time, it can differ depending on other situations. It might be 5 minutes. It might be coding somebody for 20, 40, depends on comorbidities. If we don't get them back, that ROSC, return of spontaneous circulation, time of death can be called. All right. So we have our asystole. Cruise on down the line. Ease on down the road.
Okay, that looks like the sawtooth. So like atrial flutter?
It's AFib.
Or AFib.
So why is this one AFib and not a flutter?
No P waves.
Is it because it's regular?
Atrial flutter is more regular with our QRSs. So here we have tons of P waves. QRS is kind of all over the place. It's an irregular rhythm. Whereas with atrial flutter, it's going to be a lot more pretty, a lot more organized. So what are our causes of AFib?
I know old age can do it, but also heart, like congenital heart abnormalities.
Does it have to do with something with the electrical signal not being processed right in the heart?
Like we just, yeah, we have too much, we have too much electrical activity going on. So the cardiac cells just stimulate and they're firing like crazy, like all over the place. And that's what's causing all those P waves. So this can happen for any number of reasons. It can happen after surgery, it can happen during stress, it can happen because of which valvular disorder?
Mitral.
Mitral valve disorders, because mitral valves cause atrial problems. Coronary artery disease, any number of things can cause it. We just have way too much electricity going on and it fires kind of all wonky and all over the place. So some people can live with AFib their entire lives and they're totally fine. What are some treatment options for AFib though?
Warfarin.
Okay. We want to get them on a blood thinner. Why is that?
Because it'll clot super easily with AFib.
How come?
I want to say because, well, the atrium's always firing, the ventricle sometimes will, and so it'll just kind of like clot up in a sense. That's just what I understand. Yeah, like, I don't know.
It's like churn while it's inside the heart with these deformities. I don't know how to word it better than that though.
So with fibrillation, are the atria really contracting? No, they're like shaking, right?
No.
They're kind of, so it's not going to actually squeeze out as much blood as it should. So what can happen with AFib is we have pooling because it's not going to pump it out. And if we have pooling, clots can form. And so with AFib, they'll be on a blood thinner because those, they're so prone to clots because of what's happening in their atria. And when, if the clot were to get out, can clot land in the lungs, definitely an issue, or land somewhere else. So definitely anticoagulation. If it's a new onset, all of a sudden they're in the hospital and whack, they flip into AFib, what could they possibly do for them? Anything?
They could do a cardioversion if it's less than that 48 hours, or they could do, is this one where you could possibly do like amiodarone and then the epinephrine if that's not effective, or is this just like a cardioversion?
So they can cardiovert. They can schedule this after they've been on Coumadin for 6 weeks. They can plan the cardioversion. Or they can get placed on amiodarone if they're symptomatic. So this is the big thing. Are they having signs and symptoms of decreased cardiac output? Because that's going to dictate what they're going to do. Regardless, if they have AFib, they need to be on a monitor. We need to be watching to make sure that they don't have any signs of clots, that there's no neurological changes. And kind of go from there. What is the difference between cardioversion and defibrillation?
Defib is for VTAC and VFib when it's pulseless. And with a cardioversion, it'll like shock them at a certain, not on the R or the T wave, something like that. I don't remember. I don't know.
We don't shock them when they're on the T wave because that's when the ventricles are repolarizing. So if they shock on that T wave, it causes that R on T phenomenon, which causes the torsades.
Okay.
Which is very advanced, but cardioversion is a planned synchronized shock that the person is conscious, they have a pulse. And we're just trying to get them into a normal rhythm. We give them propofol, aka milk of amnesia, kind of chill them out. We buzz them and hopefully get that rhythm into a normal point. With defibrillation, they are not conscious. They do not have a pulse. And it is a life-saving effort to get them back going. the only two rhythms that we can defibrillate are pulseless VTAC and VFib.
Hey, I just got a question. So with atrial fibrillation, the SA node is getting that electric signal. And that's what, you know, why we have the big waves and stuff like the QRS, but then it's like the atrium, like they don't know what to do. And so that's what all those little tiny squiggly lines are. And it's just not regular because they're just kind of bouncing around. If you've ever seen a picture, they're just kind of bouncing around and all of a sudden that electrical signal happens again. So that's how we can kind of tell like that it's just the AFib. Does that make sense? Kind of.
To me, it does. They're bouncing and bouncing and bouncing. I have a cool video. I will try to find it while we're doing this that kind of shows you what happens electrically between atrial fib and atrial flutter. So let's go to the next question.
So on the AFib though, sorry, just going back to that, when a patient has that and you feel their pulse, is that what you would describe as thready?
No, thready will be kind of like, so it's not bounding, like you bounding, you really, really feel. Thready is kind of like you feel it, but it's rapid, but you can't feel, it's like light to the touch. So you can feel it, you know that it's fast, but it's really delicate.
Okay, so this one would just be irregular then.
This one would just be irregular. And you really, with AFib, you'd really just hear it. Like if you listen to, you're doing your cardiac assessment, you can hear the irregular heartbeat. It'll be like your love doves are off because your loves are your atria, your doves are your ventricles. So your loves are like, it's like all sorts of like wonky noises. Okay. Hi, buddy. All right.
Would it be ventral tachycardia, VTAC?
Not VTAC.
Is it SVT?
This is SVT. Excuse you, sir. He wants attention. So what makes this SVT?
It doesn't have a P wave.
Yeah, the P wave is kind of hiding somewhere. It's getting eaten up by like our T wave because it's just rapidly, the heart rate is going so rapidly. We typically see, what are the causes for SVT? I'm not going to tell you. You're going to tell me.
Is it an abnormality in your heart's conduction system?
Okay. It's an issue with the ventricle, right? The ventricle's like pumping really fast. But I don't know why it's happening. Could this be medication induced? Like you're on some type of stimulant? Or maybe if you're on meth, this happens.
This is the nice rhythm for meth heads or crack. It causes that rapid heart rate. So with SVT, we have a heart rate greater than 150. We still have QRSs, so we know that the ventricles are pumping and they're doing what they're supposed to do. And it's regular. We look at the spacing between our QRSs. It is even throughout. So it's a regular rhythm. It's just too fast and our P waves are hiding. This can be caused by drug use, alcohol, some medications, caffeine, any type of stimulant can just cause the heart to beat too fast. So how do we treat SVT?
The vasovagal or those maneuvers to switch it.
That Valsalva maneuver?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Could you give him like a medication to drop it, like an anxiety medication? Or would you not want to do that?
Adenosine.
Adenosine. Control Alt Delete. Let's restart.
If
they don't flip out of it themselves. A lot of time with SVT, it'll present itself as a burst. So it'll be just like normal sinus rhythm. And then all of a sudden it'll be like, and then it goes on. So some kind of like rapid, they'll have a burst of VTAC or SVT. So vasovagal, adenosine, beta blockers can help. We start with the least invasive and kind of work our way up. And usually it's unless they're symptomatic. For the most part, they kind of flip themselves out of this pretty quickly. It has a quick onset, but they need to be on a cardiac monitor. I always enjoyed this rhythm. It's cute.
Well, I think finishing your COTAC exam might make you come out of that too. I just thought I'd add that.
Not a bad analogy there.
This is the Winky Bulbach heart drop. It's like the second type one, something like that.
Awesome. So how do you know that this is the Winky back?
So it gets longer and then it drops.
Mm-hmm. Because we have to look at the whole strip all the way down. So I'm missing a QRS and I look at my P wave, it's pretty far apart. It's greater than 0.2. I look at my next one, it's even farther, and then boom, I'm missing it. So really that's why we have to look at the whole thing. Causes of my favorite rhythm. Anybody remember? Usually heart medications, DIG, something like that can put them into a second degree heart block. So we tend to reduce the meds or eliminate the meds, kind of go from there to see what we're going to do. Watch their oxygen level, watch their output. It's not the worst rhythm that they can be in, but it's definitely not the best. And this can easily progress to another one. So with PR intervals, it's talking about the length of time it's taking to get from the atrium to the ventricle. Because our QRS is that ventricle talking. Our P wave is our atria. So with a heart block, the amount of time that it takes to get the message to get from the atria to the ventricle is impaired. First degree heart block, it's just too long. It's a normal sinus rhythm, but that connection is delayed for whatever reason. Second degree type one, it takes longer, and then at one point the ventricle misses it altogether, and that's why it drops. And I'm not going to go into the other ones because those are going to be somewhere in the next couple of them. But typically we just discontinue the med and continue to monitor with this one. But you should be able to see the distance with the P wave growing until we have this little cheese standing alone. Okay. 600. This one's not fair.
This one's that A flutter.
Yeah, is this atrial flutter? Because you guys said it's like regular.
Yeah, and this one actually, it's not always regular. Often it is. So that's why I'm like, this isn't fair because this is an irregular rhythm because my QRS is all over the place. But if you look at these P waves, they're pointed like the sawtooth. So that's that characteristic of this. So that's the big difference. It's caused by an abnormal circuit in the atria. Could cause from high blood pressure, heart failure. We're going to medicate them, vagal maneuver, If they're unstable, we can cardiovert, anticoagulants. As a nurse, provide emotional support, provide education, watch for signs and symptoms of blood clots and PEs. If they're on thinners, watch those labs. If they're on warfarin, what labs are we looking at?
The INR and the PT.
The PT and the INR. Not the PTT, not the APTT, just the P and the T.
So someone told me a good way to remember the heparin is you need a pair of T's. So I can't remember how he said it, but it's heparin is H-E-P-A-R-I-N. So you need a pair of T's for heparin, and that would be the APTT, right?
Yeah, that was, he said that in our class last week, right?
Yeah, I think it was Dylan. Heparin
has like a pair in.
So you need
the pair of T's. The one. Yeah.
So on the exam though, like, would we, I don't know, like, would we just have to know like how to treat this kind of rhythm? That's kind of what we'd need to know more than just identifying it because the pictures aren't on there.
And what treatments you would anticipate, what teaching you would have to provide. So if they said, you know, something like the patient has atrial flutter, the nurse has been providing education, what statement would indicate a need for further teaching or that the teaching has been effective, and you pick out the statement from that. So if they said, I will start eating a spinach salad every week or every day, well, that would mean I need to teach you something, because if I'm going to start something, that means I wasn't already doing it. If it said I will continue to eat my spinach 3 times a week, that'd be okay because they've always been doing it. And remember, with warfarin, we want to maintain our vitamin K. So looking sometimes at the verbiage of statements can be helpful. Or I will monitor for signs and symptoms of bleeding. Yay, great, they get it. That sort of thing. Okay, cruising right along.
Is this sinus bradycardia?
This is not sinus brady.
Dang it.
I think this is a first degree heart block.
This is not.
Is it the third degree heart block?
This is a third degree heart block. It's not pretty, but our P waves and our QRSs are not talking to each other. The P waves march out, actually. And, you know, they're pretty even. The Qs are doing its thing. P waves is doing its thing. There's no connection between them whatsoever. Trying to think here. Causes of third degree heart block. Drugs. Like medical drugs, like cardiac drugs, digoxin, valvular heart diseases.
The patient would already be in like a type of heart failure, right? And then whatever we're giving them is messing with it, or?
Potentially, it definitely could be. They could have an MI and afterwards, this is what they're left with, or anything that's caused damage to the heart. So people with heart failure absolutely could end up in this rhythm at some point. but basically there's some kind of damage has occurred. We are nothing is talking to each other anymore. These patients are usually symptomatic, meaning we're not having good cardiac output. So we're gonna treat them with atropine. They need a pacemaker. So first we start with that transcutaneous pacing. We put those Zolpads on the patient and it starts helping them. It starts pacing until a permanent one can be placed. But we need to restore cardiac output because these patients will not be perfusing well. Eliminating the cause and then keeping them on a monitor, watching to make sure that they're not becoming symptomatic. we will see a change in their mental status with this because they're not perfusing well. So they might be, will have that change in their level of consciousness. But this is something that definitely needs to be treated. And the number one way that we treat that is pacing in some way, shape, or form. Okay. How old is bad boy?
That's VTAC.
This is VTAC. So, what do we need to know about VTAC?
Isn't it shockable?
Yep.
No, pulseless VTAC. Pulseless VTAC. Never mind.
So your first step would to be
check for a pulse.
Yep. Don't overthink it. 100%. Your patient is shown to have VTAC on the monitor. The nurse's first step would to be check a pulse. See if the monitor is actually what it's doing. So if they have a pulse, what would you want to do?
Shock it back into rhythm? No. Yes.
Not if they have a pulse.
No.
First and foremost, least invasive. She wasn't looking at me when I did that.
No. Oh, I wasn't. What were you doing?
I was just had my head up here. Act like you're pooping, but don't poop.
Oh, yes. Bear down. Okay.
It's the easiest way, because if you tell somebody to bear down, they're going to look at you like, what? Have them strain like you're pooping, but don't poop, or to blow on a straw. Because if you're blowing triggers like that vagus nerve, it provides the same thing. Okay. So. Basovagal maneuver. If that doesn't work, amiodarone. And then they can look at like calcium channel blockers or beta blockers to give as well to get them out of it. We can't stay in VTAC. It is not a rhythm that is compatible long-term with life. We need to get them out of it. If there is no pulse with VTAC, we need to immediately defibrillate the patient. But finding out if they have a pulse is our priority if we see VTAC on the monitor. And then everything else kind of comes after it, ABCs, that sort of thing. Our goal, get back into a normal sinus rhythm or something a lot nicer than what we have going on here. Causes of VTAC.
Heart attack.
Okay. More drugs. Our illegal drugs, our stimulants can cause VTAC, any type of stimulant. Electrolyte abnormalities, potassium. Remember, the heart does not like when potassium is out of whack. Any condition that's caused issues with the heart in the past. All right.
So we're going to have to know kind of what causes these rhythms too. Or mainly just how to treat them.
If there is a cause with it.
Okay.
But this one.
Is this the first degree block?
This is a first degree heart block. How come?
Because of the prolonged PR intervals.
Yeah, this one kind of tells you right there, you can see the PR is pretty long. So remember the itty bitty 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 boxes, 0.04. So one big box is going to be 0.2 seconds. So if our PR interval is bigger than a big box, we have a PR interval greater than 0.2. And this one is probably, I'd say, a good 7 or 8 boxes. And it's prolonged throughout. So it's a normal rhythm. It's sinus rhythm with a first degree heart block. So that it's just taking a very delayed time to getting to where it needs to be. Causes of first degree heart block are usually just the medications that they're on. and we don't do anything for it. We're going to continue these cardiac meds, but we're going to continue to monitor them. And we don't, they're not symptomatic. There's not anything that goes along with this. It just happens. So R is far from the P. Then you have a first degree. That's a boring rhythm. And last but not least,
VFib.
This is VFib. With VFib, we
shock.
What did you say?
No.
You said shock. Yeah.
Yeah. Shock.
I thought you were gonna say what I said in class. VFib, we defib. We need to buzz them. Causes of VFib. Any type of damage to the heart muscle, an MI, hypoxia, drugs, acidosis of any kind. But basically, we have no QRS, we have no P waves, no T waves. Our heart at this point is just fibrillating. We are not pumping, we don't have a heart rate. These patients are not conscious. Defibrillate, start high quality CPR, ACLS drugs, epi, that sort of thing, and get them back as soon as possible. This is a lethal rhythm. Any of the other heart rhythms?
Is this, is the most common dysrhythmia in patients with a cardiac arrest?
They usually are in VFib first. Yep.
Okay.
Sinus Brady. What happens with sinus Brady?
They have normal conduction. It's just a slow heart rate.
Yeah. Who can be bradycardic?
People who are asleep.
Absolutely. Athletes typically have lower heart rates. As long as they're not symptomatic, we don't really care. So as long as they're not dizzy or weak, typically they're all right. And no mental status changes. So sinus Brady will be normal rhythm. Our R's match out very pretty, but it's just less than 60. Certain medications can cause bradycardia, but again, as long as they're not symptomatic, we don't care too much. If we do care and they are symptomatic, they'll be given fluids. We might hold certain blood pressure medications to kind of restore the heart rate. But for the most part, it truly depends on if they're symptomatic or not. What about sinus tach? What happens with sinus tachycardia?
Abnormal rhythm, but it's beating really fast.
Yep. PQRST, but just rapid, greater than 100. We have a P before every QRS. What causes your heart to race?
When you're taking a COTAC exam?
Stress?
Drugs.
Mm-hmm.
Anxiety. Probably medications.
Mm-hmm.
Caffeine, right?
Yes, 100%. Mm-hmm. Infection, injury, pain. So usually with tachycardia, if we can treat the cause, we can get rid of the tachycardia. So with infection, we give them antibiotics, we give them fluids, it calms down very nicely. Stress, we figure out ways to, you know, kind of relax, the heart rate comes back down. We just need to eliminate those potential triggers or stimuli to help reduce that heart rate. Another one that's typically not overly concerning unless they're symptomatic. And we can then look at things like if nothing is working, there's not an infection, there's not a stress, we can look at things like blood levels, electrolytes, thyroid. Get there eventually. Thyroid issues can cause, you know, issues with the heart rate. So, all right. EKG questions.
Let's do I can feel my face.
I can't feel my face for 100. Yeah. Can we start at the top or at the bottom?
Well, let's start at the bottom.
Yeah, you like the high one.
Yeah.
I just want to get it out of the way.
So your patient moves their hand away when you apply pressure to the nail bed. The patient can make words but not form coherent sentences. They open their eyes to pain but not to speech. What is your patient's GCS?
Five. They can open their eyes, but not to speech. Is it going to be like 8? Like 8 or... So when they, is the motor response of moving their hand away, is that an abnormal flexion?
That's normal flexion.
That's normal flexion. Okay. So 9?
It is a 9. So your eyes are at a 2. They open their eyes to pain, not to speech. Pressure is pain. I guess they don't want to say we're inflicting pain on anybody, but we are. They're verbal. They're making words, but it's not coherent. That's going to be a 3. And then your motor is going to be a 4. So they have a GCS of 9. Again, you will never have to memorize this, but you would be able, if you are given a glass cow, they're going to give it to you and you have to be able to break it down. What do we use a GCS for?
Isn't it neurological function?
Okay. So what are some instances that we would want to do, that we could do a GCS for?
A head injury.
I think it helps identify hemorrhagic strokes too.
Anytime something is off in the nugget. So if our brain is off, we're not making sense, it can help dictate that something is going on with the head in some way, shape, or form. It could be trauma, it could be a stroke, it could be poor oxygenation. There could be many causes for it. So GCS helps us evaluate neurological function. Okay. All right.
Take it away, Christy.
I don't even know what luft balloons are. Let's try that for 100.
These are our aneurysms. You want, we can,
okay,
100.
Yeah.
All right. So how is an aneurysm formed?
I thought it was a dilation at a weak point in an arterial wall.
100% correct. So where can an aneurysm form?
In an artery, anywhere, right?
Anywhere. Any artery could form an aneurysm. It gets weakened. So I don't want to dive too far into it. I don't want to give other questions away. But yep, we have a weak point for whatever reason. We have some risk factors. I guess that'll be question 2. What are our risk factors for an aneurysm?
Hypertension. Is coronary artery disease a risk factor?
Mm-hmm. Atherosclerosis.
Mm-hmm. Male's history of syphilis or family history of aneurysms.
Being male, males are more likely to have aneurysms than women. Smoking will get you anything cardiac. When in doubt, smoking will, choose it. I swear, it's a risk factor for everything. Blunt force trauma could force an aneurysm. Uncontrolled hypertension, high cholesterol, and age. Where am I going now?
I don't know. There's just so many to choose from, which is great. We're getting lots of practice. These boots are made for walk-in 100.
Okay.
Raynaud's. I can't remember how to say that. Raynaud's.
Yeah, so this is Raynaud's. So what happens with this?
Isn't it like it's from stress and like extreme cold temperatures? It's where they vasoconstrict, like the vessels vasoconstrict and they can't get blood to the extremities.
So is this a venous problem or an arterial problem?
Arterial.
It is an arterial problem. Treatment for this would include?
Avoiding like the cold and lessening your stress levels.
Yep. Reducing those triggers. So anything like the stress, the cold, those are the big ones with that. If it starts affecting your ADLs, meaning how you're doing your life, your activities of daily living, what type of medications could patients be prescribed potentially?
Calcium channel blockers.
Calcium channel blockers, your amlodipine, diltiazem, all those goodies. All right.
Remember, it's an arterial problem because it has A's in it.
There you go.
Yeah.
Let's do bad medicine for 100.
Get that farm in. Oh, well, speaking of calcium channel blockers, what are the dietary restrictions of amlodipine?
No grapefruit juice.
Yeah, no grapefruit.
Yep. No grapefruit juice. It causes a toxic interaction. That was an easy one.
Let's do bad medicine for 1,000.
Adenosine. No, amiodarone. It's one of those two.
Who wants to help her out?
Is it adenosine?
It is adenosine. I always, like, when I drew my farm cards out, I always drew like a P wave, and then I made the A like a QRS, and then a flat line, and then the adenosine. Like, I don't know. That's why my mind works.
Good one.
So yeah, this is the nurse poop your pants drug, because the heart literally stops and there will be a big pause and you're like, please restart, please restart, please restart medication. We didn't talk about this a ton, but this one's usually given with a stopcock on the IV. They push it. We watch, we wait, we hope, we pray it restarts and gets them into a more regular rhythm. So our sustained VTAC, sometimes with atrial fib, we can do this, but this is, yeah.
Isn't that the one where, I don't know if you warn your patient, but it feels like they're going to die for just like 5 or 6 seconds. So like in the spelling of adenosine, I have these dumb ways of remembering things, but adenosine, if you want to go back to that, go back to the picture of it. So if it makes you feel like you're dying for just like 5 or 6 seconds, if you look at the word, it D-I-E.
Oh, die. There you go.
Die. You feel like you're going to die for 5 or 6 seconds.
See, and that is something that would have helped me too, because that's the way my mind works. So I get you.
I know. It's sick and twisted, but it helps me remember.
You'll be a good ER nurse. All right. Should I keep going with the drugs?
Okay. Yeah, just pick whatever you want.
You're right in the middle. So what are some of the classes of drugs used to treat hypertension?
ARBs, ACE inhibitors, ALOLs, beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, diuretics.
One more.
Benzos
can lower blood pressure, but they're not used to treat it like on a normal basis. It's one of those happy side effects because it chills you out. Clonidine. Do you guys remember what kind of medication clonidine is?
Is it an anti-seizure?
It's an alpha-2 agonist, I think.
It is an alpha-2 agonist. Yep. So those are the ones. That's what this is, right from your slide. It, and that slide tells you the things to monitor for each. Diuretics, which side effects to look for with electrolytes. Calcium channel blockers, no grapefruit juice, watch for swelling. ACEs and ARBs. ACEs, watch for that cough. ARBs, peripheral edema is an issue. Angioedema can happen with either one of those. Life-threatening airway obstruction, lips, tongue get super massively swollen. Beta blockers, be careful with your diabetics. It can cause a spike in their blood sugar. And we don't just stop beta blockers abruptly because it can cause rebound hypertension. So it'll lower and then all of a sudden, and our Centra alpha-2 agonist can cause erectile dysfunction. Okay.
The allols, beta blockers.
Our beta blockers will lower blood sugar.
They can mask hypoglycemia so they won't know they have it. Mm-hmm.
All right. Side effects of this drug class include dizziness, low blood pressure, or a dry cough.
ACEs.
ACE inhibitors.
These are your ACEs. I am an anticholinergic medication that raises the heart rate. What med would we give to raise the heart rate?
Epinephrine.
Epi will raise it.
It's not atropine, is it?
It is atropine.
Okay. Thank you, Pixarize videos.
I don't know what they are, but I'm glad that they work.
Oh, I can't. They don't work for me. They just get me so all over the place. I hate them.
Are they like the Picmonix?
Yeah.
Tell the story.
I don't like Picmon. Yeah, I don't like Picmonix, but yeah, the Pixarize worked for me. But yeah, it's a guy in a tropical shirt. And yeah, it's amazing. But yeah, that's why there's a lot of different things out there for different people.
100%. All right. Drugs used with peripheral artery disease include what drugs? I don't think that's worded great. Sorry. What do we treat peripheral artery disease with?
Cholesterol medication, statins.
Mm-hmm. And what else?
Antiplatelets.
Antiplatelets. Same thing we would treat coronary artery disease with, because it's the same thing, but it's the arteries in our like legs and feet. All right, so what labs are associated with the following meds?
So warfarin is PT, INR, and then the heparin is, we need a pair of T's, so that's APTT, right? Okay. And enoxaparin, not totally sure.
We need labs, right?
Is that one weight-based?
It is a weight-based med.
But it doesn't need labs. Right?
If anything, what could we look at?
Your hemoglobin and hematocrit?
And like your platelets.
Platelets.
Okay. See what's going on. What should we, I don't know that we talked about this, but there's one test, no matter what kind of blood thinner you're on, we should check.
Is it a D dimer?
Not a D dimer. That'll tell us if there's a clot present. We didn't go into this a whole lot, but anybody who's on anticoagulants, we'd check their stool to make sure they're not bleeding. So we do a guaiac, which we get into guaiac in like 2 weeks. So don't stress over it. I don't know where I got that question from. So.
That checks for like the occult blood that's kind of hidden in the stool.
Mm-hmm. Four or seven?
Well, let's do I can't feel my face for like 700. Okay. Let's go back to that.
Okay. Your patient has expressive aphasia. What are ways to effectively communicate with them? This is a great question. So I saw typing and I heard something about a chart.
Like a picture chart. Like if you have some pictures and you can have them up on the wall, or just basic yes and no, like nod yes or no, like shake your head no.
Because of expressive aphasia means what?
They have problems communicating. So they might not know. Well, they might be thinking yes, but doing no or whatever, right?
They can't say what they want to. They want to say the dog is running across the street and they can't get the words out, or they'll confuse words. How they're actually speaking doesn't connect. Mm-hmm. So like you guys mentioned, communication boards, asking questions that require a simple response.
What about like a whiteboard? No?
They can write and you want them to write things out or point things, absolutely. If we wanted to, because just because they can't speak the words doesn't mean that they don't understand what you're saying, right? So if we wanted to include them in their menu choices, what they're going to eat that day, what could we have them do?
Show them the menu and have them like point to what they want or circle what they want or something.
All right.
These boots are made for walk-in. Let's do 800.
Let's just see what they'll do.
All right. You must assess these six things with a peripheral vascular assessment.
Pedal pulses?
Pulses. What are your six P's?
Is pallor one of them?
Pallor.
Pain. Pokey. I don't know how to say it, but the one for cold, pokey
something.
Paralysis and paresthesia.
So pain, pallor, pulselessness, paresthesia, paralysis, and poikiliothermia, which I am still convinced is a word your textbook made up because I never heard of it before this school. I had 3 degrees before I came here and I have no idea what that means, but those are our six P's. Remember that is part of your circulation. I said that really funny, circulation. So making sure that we're looking at those when we're doing them.
Let's do bad medicine for 700.
All right. Tissue plasminogen activator must be administered in what time frame to be most effective? Ignore my typo.
6 hours.
6 hours. Less than 6 hours of the last known well time. Anything more, there's already tissue death. So there's risks, but not a lot of benefit.
Okay. Let's finish it off.
Finish him. Okay, so your patient is found to be in pulseless VTAC. CPR is initiated. What medications do you anticipate being administered?
Epi and atropine.
Atropine?
Not atropine. I think it's amiodarone.
Amiodarone.
Yep. Epi and amiodarone.
Atropine is the cardia, is the rhythm, is for dysrhythmias.
So atropine, we use it to like increase the heart rate. Like we'll use it with symptomatic.
Like, kind of like digoxin.
I'm sorry?
Kind of like digoxin.
No. Well, digoxin will lower a heart rate, but atropine will raise it.
Okay. I need to work on those. Okay.
So we got peripheral diseases, aneurysms, strokes. This is where we're at. What's left?
Left balloons for 1,000.
Aortic dissection contributing factors include. So what causes an aortic dissection?
The hypertensive crisis, emergent. Mm-hmm. And kind of an aneurysm.
Okay. I think this is the one where Marfan's can cause it too.
Marfan's? Marfan's, high blood pressure, trauma. Any type of trauma can cause a weakness and cause that aorta to start to tear. Remember, it's that endothelial layer inside that's starting to tear, and it creates that false lumen. Blood flow will cause the occlusion because it's going to go down that pathway and further tear it all the way down and occlude blood flow from getting out to the rest of the body. And drugs, illicit drugs, can cause this as well. Very, very, very high mortality rate with this. It is almost never caught in time. Like a 1 in 50,000 chance that it's going to get caught. Awful pain, pulseless arm, nausea, unbearable pain. I know I said pain once already, but it's unbearable.
Okay. Let's do the boots are made for walking for 1,000.
Oh, this is an easy one. Risk factors for VTE. What causes a blood clot?
Surgery, recent surgery. Sedentary okay. lifestyle, obesity, atherosclerosis.
Birth control.
Oh, that's a big one.
Yeah. So that's venous thromboembolism, right? That's what that is. Okay. I was thinking the heart for some reason.
No, a VTE is a DVT that's on the run. It is making its way out of wherever it was and moving its way out. So it's the same risk factors for a DVT. So surgery, immobility, oral contraceptives. What are some other things?
The obesity.
Mm-hmm.
Would injury be one?
It could be. Mm-hmm.
Could AFib be one?
Definitely. Heart failure and active cancers. Trying to think, those are the big ones. Okay.
I can't feel my face for 100.
You want to sing it too, don't you?
Oh, I so do, so bad every time. I'm just like, oh, right. Stroke.
So what does this stand for?
Why can't I think? The F is the face, symmetrical timing.
The B is balance.
Yep.
Balance, okay.
Being a little white. I call it like the white girl sway. You know, if you ever see a girl that's been in the bar for too long, they kind of start to do this. You can see the balance issues because you guys are laughing at me, but it's true. I know you guys are like in very dry areas, but you know what I'm talking about.
Got a lot of that going on here, so.
Okay. E, what do we see with the E?
Is that, I don't know. It's not expression. No, it's. The eyes? The
visual disturbances, the, yeah. double version. double blurred vision, some type of visual disturbance with that. F was the facial drooping. If it's not, if we're ever concerned about facial drooping, have them stick their tongue out, because sometimes the droop is not like as noticeable as you think it would be, but if they stick their tongue out, it will drift to the unaffected side. What about the A's?
Is that like the arm is kind of numb?
Weakness or numbness. So we have them stick their arms out. One might fall. Or if we have them squeeze like our fingers, they'll say, you know, squeeze. The grasp strength will be unequal. And what was the S?
Like slurred speech or unable to speak.
Mm-hmm. And then our T was our time. So act quickly. You notice these things, get them there. So these are what we teach the public to be on the lookout for with stroke. So when we're doing our stroke assessments, these are all things that we're looking at in a very condensed manner. Okay. Next one.
Let's do left balloons for 900.
Sometimes people have triple A's and it is managed medically because of its size. What complication must be anticipated?
The rupture of it? Wouldn't you anticipate an aneurysm? Well, for it to blow or burst?
Okay. One thing. So with a triple A, it's a type of aneurysm. Think about what happens with aneurysms and what can form.
Could a blood clot form from all of that pooling of the blood right there in the, okay.
Thrombus.
Yep. Clots can form. So we have to be on the lookout. Again, sometimes AAAs are found just by accident. They came in because they're having some other symptom. We scanned them, we found it. We're going to continue to monitor. But once it starts getting like out of control, then medical management can come into play. But so AAAs can be very, very serious, but they can also be medically managed. Okay.
I can't feel my face for 200.
Oh, so they may have poor proprioception and disoriented to person, place, and time. They may not recognize familiar faces and we may see impulsive behavior, poor judgment, and personality changes. So this would be indicative of what kind of stroke?
The frontal lobe stuff, but I don't know which side.
I know the hemorrhagic is like a sudden headache, but I'm not very good with this one.
This is just kind of like what side of your brain is it affecting is what you're asking, right? And I can't remember. So is it your left side that's your artsy, artistic, and all of that? No.
So our left is where we see, that's our language center. So we see things like if we have issues with speech and cautious behavior. They tend to be more cautious if anything happens on the left side. With the right side
then.
The right side, they go crazy. Like they are not aware of their deficits. They tend to be like, yep, I can do it. Poor judgment, impulsive behavior. Like they're taking their clothes off and running down the hallway or things along those lines. So that was trying to think, let's see here, what slide is that on? Do, 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 do. slide 49 in the ones that we were going, I think it was 49. You had your left stroke versus your right stroke.
Oh, so I got it.
Yep. Left is going to be your language. Your analytical thinking can be impaired. Slow. Right. We have spatial awareness, depth perception issues. Definitely more impulsive behavior. And that altered perception of the deficits. Okay.
These boots are made for walking 900.
So with peripheral artery disease, feet should be in which position and why?
Isn't it the dependent position because it's not painful?
Because?
It's forcing the blood to go down and work its way back up.
Absolutely. By having your feet in a dependent position, it's forcing the blood to get to arteries because of gravity. Versus if they're elevated, it can't force its way to the feet because the arteries take it to the feet. So we want the Ruber.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's do the stroke. I can't feel my face for 900.
Ooh. Interventions for stroke patients include
TPA or TPN. It's TPA.
If it's what kind of stroke and within what time, what kind of
within 6 hours of an ischemic stroke. Are you meaning like prior to or like?
So your patient had a stroke. What are you going to do for them? What are your concerns?
Oh, hurry and get them to medical attention, seek medical attention.
So let's say we want
to know the last time that they were like coherent or normal.
Okay.
So
let's say it's like 3 days after they had their stroke.
What fall is our risk? Give them, so they don't get another stroke, like give them anticoagulants and maybe clot busters.
Like aspirin?
Potentially. So don't think meds though.
No.
So let's say this is 3 days after a stroke. Okay. They confirmed it. They did they did the things that they needed to do for the stroke. You're caring for that patient now. As a nurse. Somebody that has had a stroke, what is our primary goal?
Is it the airway?
Do we want to restore what they've lost, like get them therapies, occupational therapies, physical therapies, speech, swallowing?
What do those things do? They prevent something.
Further clots and deterioration.
So our goal for somebody who has had a stroke is to prevent secondary injury. We want to prevent other things from going on. If they can't move half their body, we want to prevent issues with atrophy. So there are certain things that we do for our stroke patients to prevent secondary injury.
So like safety is a priority.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Like turning them because they can't really turn their body, preventing pressure injuries and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Oral care.
Mm-hmm.
Assessing like putting their mattress on the floor so they don't fall.
The lowest position or something.
Yeah. Injury prevention, safety modifications, support, both emotional, whatever support they need, helping them with changing positions. Feeding is an intervention that may need to be done. So do you know how to safely feed someone?
Don't you have to do the swallow test first to make sure that they can actually even swallow like a sip of water or something?
Yeah, if they have like a gag reflex.
When they're swallowing, what do we tell them to do with their chin?
Tuck it into their chest.
Yep, so we're flexing. Mm-hmm. Watching for aspiration. Remember, with a diet change or a new prescription of food, first feeding has to be done by a nurse. It cannot be done by anybody else because CNAs can't suction. So if they take this new fluid and they end up choking, they can't suction, but a nurse could. So the nurse needs to do the very first feeding.
And so you should have suction equipment by the bedside. Is that an intervention?
Always, yep. Okay. So let's prevent further injury.
Woo, that was a hard one. Okay. I can't feel my face for 300.
And I'm with you. hemorrhagic and ischemic.
And not really a stroke.
Oh, TIA.
There we go. Whitney got it. TIA, which is a precursor to an ischemic stroke. Like, hey, something's wrong. So remember, with TIAs, we have stroke-like symptoms. They might start testing positive. Yep, they have facial droop. Yep, they cannot express their words. They don't have good arm strength. But within 2 hours or so, they are totally fine. It was like a false alarm. But definitely it's a warning sign that something is going on. Okay.
Let's do these boots for 200.
I am the primary cause of peripheral artery disease.
Coronary artery disease.
I will accept that answer.
And you know how I remember that? Here's another trick. So CAD causes PAD. Yeah.
There you go.
Wait, what?
CAD, coronary artery disease, causes peripheral artery disease. So CAD causes PAD.
What? That works.
I wrote that on my study guide.
So peripheral artery disease is basically coronary artery disease, but in our lower extremities. And what is coronary artery disease caused by? Atherosclerosis, buildup of plaques, weakening of the blood vessels, or thickening of them. It can happen anywhere. Other causes also include high blood pressure, diabetes, age, smoking, all those modifiable risk factors of coronary artery disease. Awesome.
I can't feel my face, 800.
The patient says they can only see half of the objects in the room. This finding is known as what?
Hemibiopsia, it's something like that.
close enough. Hemianiopsia. So half of the vision field is obscured. We cannot teach them how to see. It can possibly be returned over time, but like unilateral neglect, they don't realize that that arm is there. We can teach them to use that arm and remind them to use that arm. With hemianiopsia, if they can't see, they can't see. There's nothing, we can tell them that the object is there, but we can't teach them to see.
Well, and if you break down that word, hemi is like half, and then A is without, and opsia is vision.
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of tells you what it is in the word.
100%.
Let's do the left balloons for 800.
Sharp, sudden, severe abdominal or back pain, hypotension, tachycardia, pulsatile mass in abdomen are commonly presented symptoms of what complication?
Isn't this the abdominal aorta?
Mm-hmm. So these all mean that I don't like the way that I worded the answer, but a rupture is about to occur. Because once it is not pulsing anymore, we've already ruptured. But sharp, sudden pain means it's coming. And it should say hypertension. So we have high blood pressure with that. I think I created this when I was like late at night.
I can't feel my face for 400.
Impairments may include aphasia, agraphia, and slow performance. They may be aware of the deficits and may experience anxiousness or guilt.
So they can't speak, and then agraphia is where they can't write. Mm-hmm. Slow performance, and they are aware of these, and they may be anxious or guilty.
Kind of the opposite of the other side.
Oh, it's the left-sided one, the left-sided stroke.
Yeah, left side. Yeah.
So remember, if we're saying they had a left-sided stroke, what physical symptoms would we see impairments on, or what side of the body?
The right side.
On the right side. Right.
Yep. So left-sided stroke means right-sided impairments, and right-sided stroke means left-sided impairments.
I think there's a really good picture from, I don't know if it was from patho one or patho two, but Dr. Greg had a really good picture where it kind of divided the brain, and it had like, I'm a very visual person, and so I need to look up that picture again.
Share it so I can post it, because I don't have it.
If I find it, I'll send it to you.
Okay, perfect.
Let's do these boots for 700.
One way of looking at this is stable angina of the gluteus maximus.
Is this peripheral artery disease?
So yes, but this is a description of that hallmark sign of peripheral artery disease.
Intermittent claudication.
Intermittent claudication. So we have pain when we are doing something, and it goes away when we stop it. So it's like stable angina of the butt. Hallmark sign of peripheral artery disease. I was trying to be professional with saying gluteus maximus instead of butt on the screen.
Let's do the lufts for 700.
The lufts for 700. How is an aortic dissection treated?
The patient dies. I don't know. you what don't really catch. What would you? I don't know.
Is it just surgery?
Emergent
surgery. What would they do though?
They can try to repair the aorta, the dissection, like repair what's ripping.
Okay. I don't know why. I just keep envisioning, like, you know how they do the esophageal varices? Like, that's what I keep picturing, but that's probably not what they do, right?
I always pictured like the aorta like ripping off of the heart for whatever reason. I don't know why, but it's just inside that internal layer of the aorta is just shredding away from what it's supposed to be. So they can, in theory, repair it, but it happens so quickly. That's why the success rate is so low, because we don't catch it in time and it happens so fast.
Okay.
Couple more left.
In there. I can't feel my face for 500.
This scale is used to gauge stroke severity.
It's not the Glasgow scale, right? No, that's just neurological stuff.
There's another stroke scale.
The NIH or something?
That is it, the NIH stroke scale. So this is one you get specially certified for when you become a nurse. Depending on the floor, you have to go through all these modules. It takes like an hour or two where you learn how to go through it. Not every nurse learns how to do this. It might just be if you work in the ER, the ICU, a neuro floor. Mom and baby, you're never going to get stroke certified because you're probably not going to see it. All it does is we sit there and figure out, okay, this is how bad your stroke is. This is how good your stroke is. Not that you can have a good stroke, but whatever reason, there's different, like a green and a yellow and a red that determine where you fall. This would is usually done with neurology. So it exists. That's what we're trying to, the moral of the story is. I babble. Okay. It's late.
Let's finish it.
Finish him. Agnosia, aphasia, agraphia, alexia. What do these words mean?
No speech.
Okay.
No writing.
Alexia is you can't read.
Mm-hmm.
Agnosia
is like recognizing familiar things. Like they wouldn't know what a fork, it's like the little mermaid, she was using it in her hair. Dinglehopper.
Dinglehopper, yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. So agnosia, you can't recognize common objects. Aphasia, you can't speak or can't express yourself. Agraphia, you can't write, and alexia is you can't read, or you have limitations within those. So, all right.
Left balloons for 300.
I'm gonna have to go figure out what song is Left Balloons, because I'm like, I don't know what that is going for.
99 Left Balloons. It's the best song ever.
I'm like, I'm going to have to go listen to it.
I don't know why this is playing music, but this assessment finding of a AAA would be described as how?
Is that a
kind of went away
pulsating
there.
Abdomen?
That was a pulsating abdominal mass. See, I went all out with this review. There's even videos.
Yeah.
Remember, if it stopped pulsing, we probably rupture. But we don't want to see that. That is not a good thing. That means that is a big daddy of an abdominal aneurysm. But not all of them do that. Do you know the song 99 Red Balloons? That's the English version.
Yes.
99 Luft Balloons is the German version by Nena. But it was really hard to think about songs about aneurysms. And that was the only thing that I could think of. An aneurysm is like a balloon. So that's where I'm going to go with that. All right. What are we doing left?
The boots for 600.
I am the preferred position with someone with venous insufficiency.
Left lateral. No.
Is it legs up, like legs elevated?
Yep, and how
come? Yeah. Because then the blood can flow back to your heart.
It will promote venous return. So with venous insufficiency, we want the legs elevated. With peripheral disease, we want them in a dependent position. All because it's going to force or help get blood out of there. Because with venous insufficiency, we have those lazy valves. We get pooling of blood and we have kind of like an edema. So by elevating them above the heart, it can help get them up out of the way. Okay. Where did you go? Where were you? Oh, okay. What's next? Sorry.
Let's do boots are made for walking for 300.
So in this peripheral disorder, leg hair is absent and not because they got a wax.
You're not getting any blood flow down there.
Venous insufficiency? Something with the veins?
It's not going to be the veins.
Oh,
the arteries. Is it just PAD? Oh, okay.
So with peripheral artery disease, because we have decreased blood flow, hair growth is going to be minimal or absent.
Yeah, because the arteries, okay, yeah.
Mm-hmm. They're going to be occluded. We're going to have weaker absent pulses, no leg hair, cool extremities, pain when they are elevated, or not pain, but like paleness to it, And then when they're in the dependent position, they'll get kind of red and force that blood down there.
600 left balloons.
Symptoms of aortic dissection. I think we kind of talked about this a little bit.
That severe pain you said. Pulselessness. Isn't that what you said? Pulselessness, pain. Yeah, mm-hmm. On the arm, on that arm.
Love that sudden chest abdominal pain, back pain. They describe it as ripping or burning. Pulseless arm, decreased level of consciousness because we're not perfusing.
Like sweating and nausea?
Mm-hmm. Home stretch.
For 400.
So in addition to surgery, AAAs are treated with what else?
Anticoagulants? No.
Because they'll bleed. We don't want to make them bleed more.
Would you give fluids?
Yes, you would. Fluid resuscitation and surgery. Mm-hmm. All right, let's finish the balloons. Because we know this one. A tear in the inner layer of the aorta.
Is this for epithelium?
Yeah, that epithelium, what's that condition called? We've talked about it. It's an aortic
aneurysm.
No. Just dissection.
Aortic dissection. We're just all really tired.
I know. It's like it can't be that obvious. There's no way to fix the question. Yep, because we talk about some of this stuff, so the answers like kind of get, you know, thrown out there. Okay, 4 or 5.
5.
So these two things can be used to diagnose peripheral artery disease. There's two tests that we do in theory.
Would this be a D-dimer?
Not a D-dimer.
Would you check their liver, their like cholesterol? No.
The strength of your pulse, like pedal pulses.
So what is that test called?
Is it an MRI?
So we do an MRA, the angiography, to look at the blood flow. That's like the best one because it's the most accurate. But then there's another test that we can do.
The stress test? Don't,
because it's not as accurate, because it is really hard to take a blood pressure anywhere aside from the arm. What's the name of that test?
Ankle brachial index.
Yes. So that is the other test. We use a Doppler. We get the pressure from the arm, the pressure from the ankle. We compare it. And then if it's above a certain range, we don't have it. If it's below it, we do. It means that we're not getting good blood flow. Again, there's a high margin of error. So anybody could do it, but the MRA is going to be more accurate. But NCLEX loves you knowing that this is ankle brachial index exists. Way too many X's in that sentence. Okay. And last but not least, this vascular disorder is almost seen exclusively in smokers or former smokers.
Atherosclerosis.
No.
Burgers?
It is Burgers disease, that nasty disease that causes the clots and the ulcer. And I cut off fingers and toes. If you are a male and you have smoked, high risk factors for that. What else? You don't like cold? Most of our arterial diseases, we don't like cold. Same thing with peripheral artery disease. We like it warm. I say we, but they like it really, really warm. Remember, if we want to warm somebody up, no heat packs directly on the skin. We want to do like warm compresses. Heating pads can cause burns because of decreased sensation. So think safety too when you're thinking about your interventions. Yeah, I could give you heat, but how am I going to do that in a way that I don't hurt you? All right, so we covered a lot of ground in this review.
Yeah, that was like 50 questions, right?
It was a lot. 60. There was 60 different things that we kind of talked about. So some of the stuff is a little bit more drawn out than others. Is there anything you guys still have questions on? If you think about, I think the hardest, I don't want to say the hardest, one of the big things that students struggle with is peripheral artery disease versus venous disease. So separating positions, what findings you would have. Remember, arterial, we want to increase circulation. So vasodilation is extremely important. Keeping them warm, dependent position. Ruber is a good thing. With venous disorders, compression, we want to push the fluid out. We want to help with elevation, get it back out of there. PAD is like CAD, so our treatments are similar. Statins, antiplatelets, we can put in catheters, we can smush arteries, angioplasty them, remove things. So I'm trying to think of things that students have struggled with in the past.
Well, we need to know much about pacemakers, or just that they do the electrical impulse for the heart.
Okay. Remember your safety concerns with those after they're placed. So if I had a pacemaker placed, no raising my arm, no golf, avoiding direct blows, no magnets, let safety people know, like, hey, don't put that over me. I have a pacemaker. My dog has the zoomies. Always carry a card with you. If you have a pacemaker, teach them so people know what make and model you have. It makes it easier for figuring out which they have. Who do we have to contact about it? Because we don't know otherwise. We talked about defibrillation. We talked about cardioversion. Is there anything else from EKGs?
So you based a lot of these questions on like the key concepts review.
That's what I used to make this. And I don't think that there's much that I missed, but reviews are, I'm pretty proud of my reviews, but that slipped by. I can't reach each, 2 weeks worth of content into, an hour and a half. Or we've been sitting here for two, so.
Yeah, this review is really good.
Yeah, the only thing that I really seen on here was pacemakers that we kind of didn't get way into, but everything else I think we got pretty good on.
Yeah.
So okay. if we memorize the poems that were on the Dr. K slides, like with the different rhythms, is that a good thing to do for the exam? Like to memorize like the differences, those little poems that he has, like the feedback or whatever, is that good to memorize those?
If they're the same ones that are on the slides that are posted, like if there's R is far from P, you have a first degree, or longer drop, now you have a wanky box. Those definitely help with figuring out your heart blocks. I don't know if it's something different or not.
Okay.
Those help when you're trying to like march things out and figure them out. Remember, we won't show you a rhythm strip, but we'll expect you to know symptoms or treatments for those. Or if we explain like, if you're going to be on medications for a rhythm, chances are there's some dietary restrictions or safety restrictions. Do do you know them? That sort of thing. So the actual picture won't exist, but the treatment of it or things associated with it, we'd want you to know. Okay. Well, thanks for hanging out with me for 2 hours.
Yeah. Thank you.
For the review, that was really good.
Yeah, I liked it. Thanks.
Let me know if you have any questions. I know that I'll be out, but if you have other questions, just send me a message and I'll do my best to respond in between games. So,
okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Have a good one.
You too.
Bye.